7:40, since well before the Ten Commandments, men and women have been tempted to commit adultery. But now social networking means there's apparently more temptation than ever as people reconnect with old flames, flirt in the safety of their own homes, or meet strangers in online chat rooms.
Connection between social media and infidelity is the focus of a documentary this morning on Radio 4. A forensic look at infidelity also discovers that websites have sprung up to offer affairs to married people.
Well, Richard Cook speaks for one of those websites, and MaritalAffair.co.uk, and Dr. Tomas Chamorro-Premuzic is researching the topic. Very good morning to you both.
Morning.
Well, Richard, firstly, what on earth are you doing offering a website which encourages people to have affairs?
Well, I think it's an important distinction to make is that this website doesn't encourage people, but it provides...
How does it not encourage them?
It provides an online forum for people who've already decided that they're interested in exploring that. So you don't find this by accident and join up not knowing what you're doing. The website's very clear what it says, maritalaffairs.co.uk. There's no mistake what you're looking for if you're joining that site. So your decision's already been made.
So you run it with a clear conscience. You're not worried about the misery that infidelity potentially could cause.
I think it's always very sad when a relationship breaks down or a marriage breaks up. But actually there are some examples of couples who've used this site to keep their marriage alive. So for example, the intimate part of their marriage may have gone, but they've decided to stay together for the sake of the family or the children. And they may both be consenting to be members of this site, and maybe there's a medical reason why they're not able to fulfil their intimate life, or maybe they've just fallen out, but they're able to stay together because of services that this site will provide.
Mm. So what has modern life changed in relation to how people operate? And then the website like that, clearly something that didn't exist before.
Yeah, there's a lot of things that didn't exist. I think it changed the scale of opportunities, the temptation, and the pace. But actually, what the research shows is that we're not happier than, say, an arranged wedding in India, you know? A lot of successful business people, men and women, get home after a heavy day at the office and browse through hundreds of profiles. They might be single or in a relationship. They can kind of customize and cherry-pick what their partner should look like. And yet, with increased opportunities and choice, that doesn't lead to increased happiness. It seems to be like an anxious desperation for competing and getting the best possible deal.
Is there a sense that because people you're sort of browsing on the internet, that is a harmless, that's like a harmless pastime? That, you know, because it's done on the internet, it's sort of not real, and that people have a different attitude to it because of that?
Yeah, it's important to point out that that's not real, but it is perceived as if it's real. You know, when you're looking at the picture on a screen, whether it's Facebook or Twitter or whatever that is, that's not real, but for you it has the same effect. And one of the fundamental human needs is the need for affiliation, to bond with others. Now, that can range from having a coffee, a beer with somebody to, you know, kind of intimacy. So for every negative news that has been highlighted about the internet and social networking site, I can give you a positive one. As Richard was saying, what if a relationship is not working and Facebook or any site enables you to reconnect with somebody from the past and that leads to a more successful relationship? What if you don't cheat on your partner, but you spend 3 hours a day browsing through profiles pathologically and you don't have time for your partner? Mm. Is that not worse than cheating?
One of the things, presumably, Richard, that the internet does, as well as offer these opportunities, is offers the opportunity to get caught.
Yes, I think that's absolutely true. And it also offers the opportunity for people to actually see these things happening in a very tangible way. People may meet in bars or hotels or nightclubs and nobody would ever know about them.
Yeah.
And actually, because these things are on Twitter and Facebook and perhaps the rise of paparazzi, catching celebrities out and what have you, this has now become something that's much more visible. And therefore, people can look at it and think it's horrific. And of course, it is always sad when a relationship breaks down. But the fact of the matter is, part of human nature is the need to find a partner, and it's something that has been going on since before the internet.
And Dr. Thomas, are we, it's a question, it's a kind of eternal question, isn't it? But are we essentially monogamous? Or is that a social construct?
It's a cultural thing, and some cultures are not, you see. So that monogamy is a goal that requires a lot of effort. And some people can make those sacrifices easier than others. As Oscar Wilde once said, you know, I can resist everything except temptation.
Yeah.
And, you know, the temptation is bigger for some than others. I think just like our job lives have changed, you know, 20, 30 years ago, we had a job for life, and that was it, and that was 9 to 5. But now people want careers, and they're the products, and they're constantly looking and shopping around, and they want something they enjoy. You also have these two types of relationships, the ones that were meant to be for life, and the ones that, okay, well, I'm with you now, and it's good, but, you know, I still keep shopping around, exactly.
Okay. Thank you both very much. Just a reminder, you can...